Welcome back, fans. This is episode number 10 of the People's News, and we of course do a weekly rant, of course, on stories that we find on the internet. I'm going to be reading dig.com.
I'll be reading Reddit. Feeling a lot better this week.
Yeah, okay, yeah. We're going to ask Daniel. Last week, I don't know if you saw the episode, we were both kind of low energy. Me from having traveled a lot, Daniel from having...
I had like a collapsed lung thing going on, couldn't breathe.
He was getting over some major internal infection stuff, so... but yeah, we're back to, 120%, right?
Or good to go.
Or even higher, who knows. We've got some local stuff to talk about to kick off the show. The Tongue on the Post Festival is coming up in Medicine Hat. And there are going to be a couple of locations outside of the college theater where they're going to have... local artists playing. Band will set up at like Inspire Cafe, From Scratch. There's a couple places downtown, basically. Nice. And we're gonna have some shooters down and around there capturing stuff and capturing the event, and we think that's gonna be another big success. Last year we
filmed it in the
theater.
That was the one you did yesterday when it was up, or last year up top on the bus parking?
No, that was the Jazz Festival.
Oh, that was the Jazz
Festival. But the other one that we did was the Tongue on the Post, and was all done inside the college theater on the stage and stuff. We have all those videos up there. There was a couple of really good ones that I've reposted, but go Google Tongue on the Post Festival or go on YouTube, check out Tongue on the Post Festival, and you'll find some of that stuff. We're going to be covering it again this year, so look forward to some new videos of local artists. Other thing I wanted to mention here, Glenn Juhas, one of the great sponsors here at comtv, has made the move over to Royal LePage Royal LePage Real Estate. I wanted to give you his Facebook page there, which is facebook.com/Glenn Juhas, GlynYuhas. So that's facebook.com/GlynYuhas. And what they offer there basically is video tours of the inside.
Oh, so you kind of get a walkthrough of it all, a little 360.
So, yeah, well, cool. Not only the 360, but it's like he's there talking you through, what's new about the home, are the appliances you see included, So he basically, brings you on a tour through the home with his camera, and they're fun to watch, even if you're not like really, seriously looking at buying a house right this moment. Sometimes cool just to see like how new houses are decorated and like, what kind of light fixtures are in, the new homes, and I don't know, all that kind of stuff is fun to watch. So check out his page, watch a couple of videos. If you are going to buy a home, then, give him a call for sure. So let's get into the show.
Yeah, I guess moving on.
All right.
First story here.
Let's see. So I found this one on Dig, and it's been a huge story throughout pretty much all national news in Canada. Canadian government declares all same-sex marriages legal and valid. And now this only comes after a little bit of a sort of gaffe, I guess you could say, by the Prime Minister, because somebody asked him about it recently. It was something to do with a couple that was married and then they wanted to get a divorce, and then something was said about how their marriage wasn't even valid in the first place, and the Prime Minister basically brushed it off and said, we're not looking at that discussion anymore. And then it was like the day after, the Justice Minister, Nicholson, comes out and says, we will change the Civil Marriage Act so that any marriages performed in Canada that aren't recognized in the couple's home jurisdiction will be recognized in Canada. So I think what they're kind of saying is like people who lived in the States who can get, citizenship here can get married here and their marriage will be considered legal.
Yeah.
But it was all after this thing where Stephen Harper had kind of messed up by giving a, not really the wrong answer exactly, but he just sort of missed a big opportunity to say that he supported gay and lesbian rights by saying we're not going to open that topic anymore. And then
trying to cover it up by allowing the other one to pass. And
yeah, exactly.
Like, let's go back and do what the Liberals didn't do.
Yeah, exactly. So he's basically like, going back on, how can I make this look like a Liberal problem, like something that they did wrong? So he's basically going back and saying this is a legislative gap left by the Liberals when they made this law in 2005. And it's like, of course, nothing's perfect when you make a new progressive law. There's obviously, there's going to be... you know, things that have to be modified over time. It's not like you could come up with a new idea for, you know, perfect society and then just overnight it's, you know, done. So I think it's kind of lame that they go back and blame the Liberals for having passed that, you know, legislation in the first place. It's kind of like, you know. But I mean, I think most people in Canada, it seems to me, at least most people that I know, even in a very conservative place like Alberta, are okay with the idea of same-sex marriage. Because, I mean, it doesn't really affect the other people all that much. I mean, I'm sure that there are some, you know, religious groups and stuff that are all about, you know, sanctity of marriage, and this is, you know... sacred, you know,
it was
holy.
Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve.
Yeah, exactly. And they have the, but it's like in the end, that how much does it actually affect that? I mean, there's a Christian family living at 101 Normal Street, and then like, you know, at you know, number 88 Normal Street, just down the block, there's a gay couple. Does it really make the Catholic family any less prosperous? You know, does it take away from them? I think people are starting to realize that no, you know, it's just really a bigotry in the end. You know, it's like, if you don't like those people, maybe that's
a you problem. As long as they're not overly pushy on it, you know what I mean, though? Like, if...
Yeah, but I mean, like, it's sort of like that with anything. I mean,
yeah, but
like,
for instance, as long as they're not over the next day handing out flyers for it, like...
Yeah, but it's the same thing, but it's like, I'm not vegetarian, right? But if I had an annoying next-door neighbor that was always trying to push me to be vegetarian, I wouldn't be like, let's make vegetarianism illegal.
No.
Nobody, but, you know what I mean? It's kind of like, yeah, there's annoying people everywhere doing all kinds of stuff, but whether or not the government should be able to go in there and get in your bedroom and say whether you're doing is illegal or not, it's kind of like, you know, just... Stay out of our bedroom, government. We don't really need you there too much. You're not helping us there. Moving on, I guess. Go ahead.
Yeah, I guess my story from Reddit here. In Italy, now the Mafia is now the top bank due to the recent economy crisis there. They take in average 140 billion euro, or whatever the currency in... I'm pretty sure it's euro there. In,
yeah.
Yeah, 140 billion, and they profit 100 billion.
Is that in like a day?
Annually.
Or annually?
Annually.
That's crazy. So there's like actual...
Oh, so they're just like storing money, and like all the banks are running out of money and everything.
That's
and,
crazy. Yeah. There must be actual like little storefronts where you can go and
they
get like same day cash loans.
20,000 small businesses and stores and everything associated with them.
Yeah, not surprised. So it's like one of those things where they've gone above... you know, whatever local government is in their way and just made their business work.
That's, well, look at like Pablo Escobar.
Scary.
When he was,
like, I wonder what else though, like, because there's always like, so that's just really some. Loaning money and stuff like that. But what else does the Italian mafia, quote unquote, do? Because I know with, there's been a lot of studies on like, is it Yakuza in
the Japan?
Japan? There's... I think it's in China, though, specifically, where there's a really big problem with child pornography, and it's because the gangs there, that's the main thing that they deal
in,
you know, because that's how they make their money and stuff. So it's like
human trafficking.
Yeah, so if the mafia in Italy is loaning out money and stuff like that, and you know, that's how they make a lot of dough, then I mean, that's still pretty nefarious. They probably but what do they do?
Too,
like, I mean, do they
like
they breaking people's legs and killing them when they're not paying back these debts?
Yeah.
Because if that's like the thing, that's really the story there. Because loaning money, I mean, at high rates, so what? Banks do that. You know, if the mafia is making a better business at it, then
why
so
not?
Be it. But what else, you know, what other terrible things does the mafia do there?
They're probably not going to lose it all, though, on a giant stock bet.
Very true, eh? That's a funny thing.
A little
it's
better
like,
business sense.
Yeah, the mafia is more like a credit union than the bank.
Yeah, exactly.
it's
the people's money.
Exactly. The mafia is not going to go risk losing everything.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
but a
no,
bank.
This is a stupid investment.
Because the mafia will never get a bailout from the people.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? That'd be
so
hilarious. Yeah, the mafia goes
to
the government.
Use it wisely.
They're like, yeah. So we had some really bad cocaine deals this year. Our fraud has been down a lot. We're really not trafficking as many firearms in Nicaragua as we used to, so can we get a bailout from the taxpayers?
In return, we can offer you protection. Like,
oh man, good one.
Awesome.
So yeah, check out the Italian Mafia there if you need a good loan, if you're looking for a new car, you know.
Keep it low-key.
Check out Vinny. So moving on, I got another story from Dig. This one, it was really kind of weird. It's the story is called Clever Thief Steals 42-Inch Plasma TV. And when I watched it, right away, I knew sort of what the gig was. So I'm going to put this one on here. I don't know if you want to come around, Vinny, take a look here. Put it on full screen, so. So dude, like, walks into the store really weird.
He's creeping around all funny, like.
And, like, I don't know, if you're watching security, I think you would think the guy's just, like, high or something, like, or
really skeptical
weird.
About something.
Yeah, like, he's walking around really statuesque, but he knows right where the camera is. He looks right at it.
Following it.
And then he walks out, like, weirdly backwards. And it's like,
some random guy in the
See, this
other
is what's
aisle.
Strange. It's like a thrift store or a pawn shop or something, because there's a bunch of just random crap everywhere.
Junk, like a bunch of vases, like coffee makers.
And it shows them like going backwards. And then all of a sudden it kind of looks like it's like almost an Apple store at the front or something.
Yeah.
It really just looked manufactured the whole way through. It looks like it's produced.
Right,
and then
there,
he comes
the
out,
smallest
and
TV.
Then look, right when he comes outside, there's a huge poster that says the world's slimmest television. Yeah. You can see the big, huge sticker on the corner of the TV, and it's supposed to be like, okay, so this guy ran away with this TV, you know? But it's so obvious from watching
advertisement.
This, that this is an advertisement, right?
Smallest
it's LG.
TV, everybody's stealing it. So slim you can hide it.
I go over
shirt.
To YouTube and I go to check it out, right? And it's like, oh no, it's just like hired, like, I don't know, some M30 films or something like that. And like, it's just a bunch of viral video stuff. And it's so obvious that what's happening here is big companies like LG are trying to, instead of spending $200,000 on a cool ad or $2 million on the Super Bowl, they just go ahead and make this viral video that's really funny, interesting, wacky, weird, whatever they use. They use some tactic, right? And they get it out there and they just say, look, like, hey, everybody steal this video, copy this video, put it on Dig, put it on Reddit, and somehow we'll generate enough interest and people will be like bombarded with that LG image twice in the video, and they'll also be saying, oh, hey, did you see that LG TV that's so thin? You can like walk out of the store. Exactly.
Like,
and that's what makes the, that's what gives the company their advertising power that month or even for that year, you know, because this is like 500 digs, you know, it's been shared around, and it says, you know, even the, you know, guy who wrote the Dig story here, it says, I watch this video and I laugh my ass off, but then I realize when I realize that he stole the TV, I'm not sure if it's legit or a promotional spoof, but regardless of what it is, the thief needs to be commended on a job well done. And it's almost like even that way of writing sounds like somebody hired him to write the story on the video to like keep that viral
keep
status
going, like,
you know, spreading out. So I think it's a testament though to
what
how
was he gonna
useful
run to after if
well,
this
yeah,
was
exactly.
real, like, did he have a car waiting? Like, I wonder if he lived close there.
Who knows? I mean, it's just, to me, it's so obvious that it's an ad that all of that is negligible.
Yeah.
And then once you realize that it's an ad, your next thing is, well, like, why? Like, who would spend money on there? Who would, you know, like,
it's
obviously
smart.
Well, LG would do that because now they've got tons of people talking about it. I mean, this has been shared on Facebook, you know, a couple hundred times already. I mean, it just came out like yesterday, I think. Just started to at least make its way around the web yesterday. So, but that's what I think is so interesting about it, that the company, you know, big companies are going
to
use this type of video to, you know, get their idea out there. It's at, you know, 400,000 already.
On its way up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As seen on BuzzFeed, which is a popular YouTube aggregation site. But yeah, you know, they're using viral video now, so they understand the importance of social media and how people are sharing things that, you know, they're not going to go on there and share the 30-second ad that says, LG now has the thinnest television in
Everybody
the world.
Everybody right away hit skip ad.
Yeah,
like,
you're going to just be like,
wasted
oh,
money.
God, wasted. But you'll skip the ad, but you'll watch that black and white security footage and you'll be like, oh, cool, he stole
a TV.
That guy
stole a TV.
So, you know, interesting way that advertising is going. And I wonder how much they paid to have that produced.
Yeah.
I wonder who came up with the idea. Brilliant producer there. I'm sure it involved a whole marketing team, but, you know, brilliant job there, guys. So move on. You have another
next
top story
from
here.
Reddit there. So, a study done in America there, posted by New York Times, marijuana smoking does not harm lungs. So, the researchers found that marijuana smoke, an exposure of 7 joint years, the equivalent to smoking 365 smokes, or joints, pipes, anything, at least once a day for 7 years, did not worsen pulmonary function. Notice that with heavier marijuana use, described as 10 joint years of exposed or more, lung function did begin to decline. And for a person who smokes both marijuana and cigarettes, the net effect is going to continue loss of lung function. But that's just because they're smoking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, in this New York Times story, interesting. They're, I mean, it seems like, yeah, they're pretty, like, you know, open liberal style paper. Sometimes you get some really good stories there. But I think this is something that's been sort of like widely known for a long time, just that now they've actually had enough time and data, because I mean you need that 7 years.
Though. Like yeah. they tested some people for actually 30 years in the study here.
So yeah, people that started smoking when smoking started.
Exactly, pretty much. And now they can see the long-term effects, which clearly are none.
So. Yeah. So I guess the greater discussion is, does it matter, period? Like, if something harms you, is that the factor that we should take into account when deciding whether or not people should be allowed to have that thing? Because you're allowed to have
alcohol,
like, of course, you're allowed to have, but I mean, there's all kinds of things that, you know what I mean? Like, I've heard of, and I've seen, you know, the show, Intervention or whatever, where they use the computer cleaner stuff.
Yeah, puff on that stuff.
And it's like, does it really, like, even if we took away all vice things, like cigarettes, alcohol, all drugs, everything illegal, people would still mix up the crap they get in their bathtub.
Well, they still have the subconscious, like, people, they have the need. They were like, oh, let's go get high.
Yeah,
and if they can't get anything, they make their own thing. Like, that's how, like, huffing started, probably. Like,
yeah, they find some cheap, weird, under the
thing,
you know,
that
kitchen
they won't
counter
get in trouble for, stuff like, yeah.
Yeah, but I think it's just, like, it's just, I don't know, it's weird that I think that's, like, the focus of all the studying and stuff like that, where I think the focus should really be, I mean, in my opinion, on what level of personal freedoms do we allow people to have to make choices.
Well, everybody still
stuff,
has, you know? Yeah, you still have the choice. Like, if you want to find something, even if it's illegal, you still, anybody, if they really wanted to, can go out and find it, right?
Well, but no, that's the thing, though, is, like, yeah, you do have the choice to go out and find it, but then by making that choice, you also can become incarcerated, which is terrible.
Yeah, but we also, like, that's what, they think it's illegal, it should be illegal because they thought it was harmful.
Yeah.
And they said for so many years that it was harmful,
right,
to get people not to.
Right.
But if there's things proving that it isn't harmful, why don't they just legalize and regulate and everything and give people, like, the easier ability to get it because they know it's less harmful?
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's just going to stop kids from, like, huffing, doing random things.
I wonder, that's the other thing, though, is I wonder, outside of the, like, highly technical lung tests that they did on these people, what other kind of things did they find? Like, these people that have been smoking for 30 years, like, what percentage of them are, like, crazy people, or like what percentage of them
actually
are
more intelligent?
Yeah, like, what percentage of them are doctors? What percentage,
exactly.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, it'd be really interesting to find out more about everything involved in the study, not so much about, like, the, because I mean, like I said, it seems like something that's been known for a long time. You don't hear about, like, oh, that guy who smoked pot, you know, got, like, a lung disease and died. It just, like, you don't hear that. You hear more about, like, you know, people that smoke cigarettes, like the thing mentioned, if they smoke both, then there's going to be, you know, more problems with people that smoke cigarettes. It's obvious, but, and it's because the other sort of weird thing about it is it's because tobacco companies own cigarettes that makes them so terrible, which kind of means that it's because nobody regulates marijuana. That's why it's well, not healthy, but that's why it's not so chemically sprayed, you know, because the people that probably grow it don't have access to all of these crazy things.
What they were trying to do instead of getting people to smoke it first, say they had to get, like, cancer treatment, stuff like that, they're finding a way to make THC, but just, like, refine it almost.
Yeah, make it like food or whatever.
An artificial, like, a pill form.
Yeah.
Like,
because that
still
makes a lot of sense. Because, I mean, like,
though it's not,
I think the people that probably need it most in a lot of cases are older people, you know, like that are getting cancer diseases and stuff like that from a lifestyle or a long life of, you know, not so healthy living.
Yeah.
And then if that's what they need when they're, you know, they're a cancer patient or maybe they have eating disorders, whatever the, you know, situation is, that when they're older, they probably shouldn't be just smoking burned plants anyways. Yeah. So it's like having, you know,
an
proper
way for
alternatives.
Them to take it.
And it seems like that could be measured better because it's like, I don't think a doctor can really measure how well you're ingesting your medicine.
This
if you're
looks
smoking
like some
it.
Good bud.
Yeah, exactly. Like, but if they have a pill form that's been like measured out and
they
more
know
about
what
it,
percent it is,
they can actually
like,
prescribe
I
it.
I think that's
properly.
Kush. Yeah. Here you go. Like,
I think this is enough to make you feel hungry.
This should be good.
Here, like, yeah, try that.
Yeah.
Although I guess that it's kind of like that with a lot of pharmaceuticals, because like with any pharmaceutical itself, like even if they're giving you pills, they sometimes will say, well, we think this is enough, but then we'll try and scale
I'll
it up or
there,
scale it down.
If that's
yeah.
not enough. Like,
so it's, you know, it's kind of always a crapshoot when it comes
I'd
to
like,
doctors
I don't
giving
know.
Us drugs.
I think that's not going to be enough. Like,
but that's the thing too, is like, so if doctors are, you know, they study for years and years and years, but then they still arbitrarily just say like, oh, you know, I think my best guess is I'll give you this much and we'll
I'm
see how that works out.
Yeah.
Then why can't we guess for ourselves? You know?
Yeah, exactly. I think I'll be good on that. Like,
I think I'll make a boat fine with this.
Yeah. So maybe instead of an apple a day, a joint a day keeps the doctor away.
Yeah, could be. Well, in terms of lung things, it sounds like something that's so counterintuitive. Like you'd think that no matter what kind of
they
smoke you're inhaling,
in a couple
that it would
of cases,
hurt your lungs.
It actually increases your lung
but
capacity.
But yeah, that's the thing, is that there was a few cases where they had found that some lungs actually increased in capacity somehow. And I was thinking because of that, like, I mean, when you see people
smoke
bongs.
All the kids taking huge rips.
Yeah, like. And I mean, I don't smoke out of bongs, but when you see people doing it, they're you know, and
then
their
giant
lungs
cloud.
Are, you know, yeah. They hold their lungs and make a big bubble. It almost seems like that's an exercise in itself.
Oh, yeah.
to you know, hold your lungs like that. So maybe it's something to do with the exercise they're getting in their lungs. Anyway, so that was a good one.
Story.
Good story. And we got some local stuff we're going to move on to here. Let's see. Ready to fight for French. This was medicinehatnews.com, and I guessed Amanda Stevenson, I'd be right. Another great story, community story by her. And this one was about how schools here in Medicine Hat are—they're having a funding issue and
bit of a debacle.
Yeah, bit of a debacle here. And the thing that could get cut is Medicine Hat School's French immersion division, where right now we have Catholic school primary to 12 French immersion available. They're saying that, you know, they might have to cut this program, and the people who are really going to suffer the most are if you're in grade 10 or 11 right now.
That have already been in
it. And you've just done a decade of French immersion.
You just wasted all that time.
Well, yeah, if you have to graduate with a non-bilingual diploma.
It's useless.
It's very limiting. I mean, hopefully the French that they've learned, I think it's, you know, it's great that they've learned that and they'll have, you know, a leg up on anybody who doesn't have that French. But getting that bilingual diploma is that's an important part of somebody's life.
You can get a job anywhere then.
Yeah, you can work. You could work a lot more flexibly in Canada.
Depending on what you want to do, and you can go anywhere. Like
so. Yeah, there's a picture here, and it shows a young lady outside the school with her arms crossed and a scowl on her face here. It says this is Melissa Halderson. She's a grade 9 student at St. Mary's School, and she's in the French immersion program, and you know, she's obviously not happy that it could be coming to an end. And so, I mean... I don't know really what can be done about this type of thing. It's right away I'm thinking, well, is it just the Catholic school? And I'm thinking, you know, hopefully there's still other programs that kids can get into
if they want to stick with French.
I don't really like the idea that some people will feel like they have to choose between culture, language, and
religion,
because those things, you know, you should be able to do them separately. I feel like you could still, if you're going to a Catholic school, I still feel like you can worship, you know, and go to a public school and learn French, you know, because your worship can happen at home and at
outside,
church and outside,
like,
of school. It doesn't necessarily have to be happening 24/7. I mean, I understand that that's what a lot of parents are going to want to fight for. And, you know, I hope there is a
Nobody
measure
does
of success
anything
there.
In a religion class, like
yeah. But you know what I'm saying? I hope there's a measure of success there that they can get you know, the French program to stick around, because yeah. Like I said, when we were discussing it earlier, that's like taking Medicine Hat's education system back like probably 20 years, you know? Like, I'm sure we probably didn't get the first French, you know, schools out here until, I don't know, 70s, 80s. I'd have to do some research, but it's always a good program to have. I mean, we have two national languages. We got to, you know, we got to have the opportunity at least for the kids to learn them both and have those, you know, those options in life. Because
English and mispronounced English.
Yeah. And then probably in the future, Spanish.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Spanish is moving further north every day. So good story, Amanda Stevenson. Like I said, get in touch with us, and you know, we like covering Medicine Hat news stories, and you've usually got some great ones. We've got another one here. Anti-smokers want bylaw for outdoor ban.
What?
So, what do you think?
That's taking away anybody's freedom. They're regulating what you can do outside. They're like, hey, no running outside. Like,
yeah.
Just because one person had their kid fall down and scrape a leg, they're saying, "No, you can't do that." Like,
yeah, it's like, Jeremy Thompson said it well, and he said it again in the article here. He says, you know, when they came out last year with the, if you're under 18 years of age and you're in a car, then nobody else in the car can smoke. If somebody else in the car is smoking, then they can get fined. Or something like that, right?
Okay, and I can kind of see that, because that way, like, you never know. A parent's driving with their kids, you don't want them having secondhand smoke, because the kid doesn't have a choice if they want to be there or not.
But that's how they sold it. They sold it like, we're protecting babies from bad mothers.
Yeah. And now they're, like, pulling everybody over. Like,
well, no, they're not. They're pulling mostly, what they're going to be pulling over is 16, 17, and 18-year-olds driving cars, smoking cigarettes. And it's like, it just seems like an invasion of the rights of the youth. You know what I mean? It's like, so, you know, they're driving around in a car smoking a cigarette. Now, that gives the police instant right to pull them over to check their IDs to see if anybody's under the age of 18 and then hand out fines. And it's just, it's so, I don't know, it's so innocuous. They're going to smoke the cigarettes no matter what.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? But, I mean, I do agree with the idea of giving a fine to, you know, a 27-year-old mom who's got two infants in the back and she's smoking cigarettes. But I always thought that that was called child neglect. I mean, you know what I mean? Isn't there something? Like,
I think they've probably made it, though, because it's less than child neglect, because...
Yeah, like, they've got to have something in there, but I mean, the whole way that they put it on us, where it's like, oh, well, smoking, and then we'll make it under the age of 18, and that passed by. And anyways, Jeremy Thompson said, oh, well, what's next? You're going to ban smoking in public. Sure enough, he comes back and says, that's exactly what I said last year. You're going to try and ban smoking in public, and...
it's probably some guy who's a shitty parent. That's all it comes down to.
Yeah, and that was the thing, too, was like, it was a guy named it, here. Like, yeah.
Straight up. That's what it comes down to.
Jason Mulholland was the name of the guy who came to the news. So he came to Medicine Hat News, and he said, my 18-month-old son is constantly picking up drop cigarette butts while playing.
Teach him, don't pick up stuff on the ground. Like, it's not that hard. Like,
it's like, even, you know...
What else is he going to pick up next, then, if nobody's throwing, like...
But how do we start regulating that? Okay, so are we going to have a force of police out there?
A common sense police, like...
Well, yeah, exactly. A common sense police that are out there, like, oh, you threw a cigarette butt on the ground. Here's your $28 fine. Like, how is that going to work? Like, it is just a common sense thing.
It's just another thing for them to hire more cops, because they have to patrol everywhere now.
True.
Like,
they have to hire a lot more cops to be able to.
There'd be a cop swinging on the play set every playground, making sure nobody's smoking in the park. Like,
but it's like, is that really the whole point of it, though? Because it's like, not every single person that smokes a cigarette near a park is trying to hurt your kid.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
know what I mean? It's like, there are some people that just smoke because they're addicted and they happen to walk through a park doing it. Maybe the thing that you're after is more ashtrays available in the city.
I can see that. Maybe you think city
workers should clean the parks more often. But the idea of banning smoking in public places is pretty ludicrous. Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, I think more about, you know, personal freedoms of other people. I mean, I do agree that an 18-month-old kid should have a nice, clean place to play, but, you know, don't put your kid down in a bunch of cigarette butts. If there are cigarette butts around, maybe move to another location. Because I've walked through the parks. I've been. There's not piles of cigarette butts in the parks, really. I mean, I think it's sort of a non-issue. But the greater issue here is the idea that people think, well, since I don't smoke, then nobody else should have to be able to do it anywhere. I should be able to just make a law that says nobody can smoke around me. And it's like, yes, smoking can be annoying to some people, but there's so many other things that are annoying to other people.
I'm allergic to dogs. Nobody have their dog outside when I'm walking.
Absolutely, I'm allergic to cats. So you know what I mean? If your cat brushes up against my leg, you should be fined $100 because it makes my eyes red and, you know, makes my nose stuffy. You know, it's like, how far do we go with this thing of how much space do you allow somebody in public? And it's like, you know, we really don't have much, you know, privacy left in public anyways. It's just like, what do you expect of people to do to make everybody comfortable in public? I mean, should we all just all wear black and white clothes, no music?
Everybody conform to everybody,
I think we both agree on that kind of a non-issue, that's sort of a silly idea. We hope it doesn't pass, but you know, Medicine Hat's been used as a sort of like proving grounds for the stuff that the Canadian Cancer Society wants to try and, you know, pursue nationwide. And while a lot of their goals are really good, I mean, Canadian Cancer Society has, I'm sure, helped tons of people that have had, you know, this terrible disease and cancer. You know, it affects a lot of people, but I think really what we've got to start doing is we've got to start looking for a cure for cancer.
How many millions have been invested?
We got to start looking for a real cure for cancer and you know, stop spending money on silly things like banning, you know, smoking in parks and stuff like that. So yeah, I think people would smoke either way. I mean, even if a law passed here that said you're going to get a $100 fine if you smoke outside, I think there'd be a lot more fines handed out, which would be really stupid, but
there's no way anybody's having to fine out. Yeah. Like, not happening.
So we'll follow that.
See where it goes,
I guess. We'll see where it goes. And I don't know, I could picture there being some resistance to that if they even start discussing it seriously. Mobs of cigarette smokers outside, you know, City Hall, just like, you know, having a smoke out or something. So we'll move on. We got two stories left. Which one's first here? I guess this story.
Your video for us?
Yeah, this was a top trending story from this weekend here. It's a video, so I don't know if we want to shoot this thing. We get an ad on it first that I can skip here. Service Credit Union, eh?
There we go.
Service Credit Union advertising on YouTube. That's kind of cool. This one was kind of cool. I'm just going to play a few minutes of it here.
What? Горки катается. Она нас, наверное, это дразнит.
Волнует.
Интересно, в какой стороне они.
Что там получилось?
Мы поедем, мы помчимся на крышечке к управлению. Клювом.
Не может захватить.
Хочет еще дальше.
It's just weird. It's like, go back forward a little here. He does it multiple times. Like, it's not like it just happened once.
He's having some fun with it.
Yeah, like, turn this down a bit. Yeah, it's like a crow having fun. Like, I mean, I don't know how we all judge the animal kingdom. I mean, we know dogs and cats because they're pets. They have a lot of like free time, you know.
But nobody
we feed
has a
them.
Crow. Like,
yeah, but the last time you saw a crow playing a game like that, it's just so weird. He's like sliding down the thing like it's a, like he's a kid playing on the hill. So that was a good sort of winter video because we're starting to get a little snow here in Medicine Hat, and I don't know if you're the type of person that goes up to the hill. You know, I thought you might find the crow tubing video kind of funny there. And we got another final story here. This is some super cool technology stuff here.
Yeah, this video to CES. This is Samsung's new smart window. So I got a video for you.
Okay, you guys, this is my favorite thing of the show. This is the Samsung transparent smart window.
Ashley Esquita from Mobile National Video.
I can actually do things like make this blinds. So I can close the blinds. I can actually see through to the little town outside. If I want to hit widget, I can check out Twitter.
So cool.
I can check the forecast for Vegas. This is so freaking cool. This is future technology right here. It's a one-sided pane, which means people can't walk by your kitchen window and see what you're looking at, so you don't have to worry about that.
That's a must.
I know that it's going into the coming months. They're mass production in the coming months, so
although, you know,
it'd
be weird. You're like staring at your TV because there's something interesting, and somebody's like outside, like taking out their garbage, and they're like, wait, why are you staring at me?
And you're like, oh, I'm just watching the window.
I'm just watching TV. But yeah, man, that stuff's totally awesome. And this is what's been, you know, as I've been watching all this CES stuff, we're seeing more and more and more LED panels for different
OLED
places.
OLED too.
Like, I mean, there's, you got it. So now we're going to have them on our windows so that you can see it when you're going outside, right? We've got an iPad. We've got, like, you know, a tablet of some kind. They're putting them on watches so that you can get, like, you know, an LCD screen, like type of thing. Microsoft came up with this video recently, which was their Office of the Future video, and it's like a whole bunch of glass surfaces everywhere, and there's basically, like, you know, information
cool
coming up on
tables
all
tables where you can send pictures.
Everything, right? And I'm thinking, like, how much, like, what is the cutoff point between how much screen we will put around us versus when we will put it right in our eye or in glasses or something like that. Like, I mean, for myself, I have glasses, so it's actually, I think, a convenient step towards the future of having screens everywhere. Because if I could have, like, some, like, screen put into these lenses, then it would be something where no matter where I looked, I could see data from something, right? Like, let's say I told, you know, I want
to totally have, like, Netflix streaming in my left eye.
Yeah, but, like, let's say you could make it, like, Netflix streaming only on this part of the wall right here, and only when I look there, because my glasses know
where
I'm looking, and they know GPS, and I know, like, everything about the house.
So augmented
it's almost like,
reality.
Yeah, you could map out your house with this augmented reality. So, like, for instance, when you're in the bathroom and you're sitting on the toilet, that area right in front of you would be like a video game console, right? Just because your glasses know where you are and what you're looking at.
What you're doing, yeah.
So it's like, depending on where you are, you get up in the morning, like, right away, you're on your wall in the morning is like I don't know, like
the weather.
A virtual mirror and the weather and, like, you know, calendars.
Daily,
like,
horoscope,
so,
stuff like
that. Yeah, I mean, I could see this stuff, though, being extremely prevalent because everybody's going to have glass windows. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think glass windows are going away anytime soon, right? And people love having a lot of open light coming into their house, and they also love big screen TVs.
That's why a lot of
how
people
nice
are going to like
gonna
those
be?
OLEDs.
Yeah, you get a whole big picture window in the front of your house, and that's the TV, and you get to build, I mean, the architecture of a room. I mean, you know, back a long time ago, it was built around a fireplace.
Yeah.
And then you'd have a radio maybe around the fireplace. And then it was, well, now we got to have a TV. So the rooms all got switched around.
Home
so that,
theater system.
You know, the fireplace is in the back now. And now the TV's over here and you got to have your own theater. And that became the focus. It would be really nice, I think, if the focus could become the window of the home. I mean, that could be a really cool sort of way of doing it. So. Yeah, man. Love that video. Love all this new technology stuff that's coming out at CES 2012, because this is the week right now of all the, you know, new
releasing
technology vendors.
Apple TV,
out all stuff.
37-inch.
Yeah, Apple TV. More news on that next week. It's all just sort of coming out right now. So I'm sure next week's show, we should do kind of like a little CES special and do like our favorite gadgets of CES, because there's been a lot of cool stuff coming out. So. I guess that is the episode for this
week.
That's
the episode, guys.
Let's do like a fist bump.
Your kid's yelling? Adam's kid's yelling or something first.
His kid's yelling at child.
What are you talking about, Glenn? Kids yelling?
Having crazy kids in the neighborhood.
Crazy kids. It's